Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Can you hear me? Is my voice clear?
Yeah, it's clear.
Okay, inshallah. I hope that you have the book with you, right?
Yeah.
Okay, inshallah. Right, okay. So, I thought as this is our first session, to help you with to make a PowerPoint presentation so that it might be helpful for you as well. Right. So this is the lesson that you wanted to do, right? Biological processes in human body.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Right. Let's do something. Whenever you want, you can unmute. After that, you can mute yourself. So it will be easy. Right. First okay. of all, let's go through the lesson. So when we speak about digestion, so there are actually two parts. First of all, it has to do with mechanical part. And also chemical part. So to make it much more clearer, so we can go it like this. It is the process by which we have the complex organic compounds, they are converted to simple ones. So the reason why we convert them into simple ones is so that we can absorb them directly into our human body. So for example, if you take a complex, let's say that if you want to observe something that is out there, let's say that you are eating rice. So what do you think rice contains? What is there in rice actually? What is it filled with? What is the
material?
Yeah, carbohydrate actually. Carbohydrate. And to be precise, it contains a lot of starch. So using our digestive system, we can break it into smaller molecules such as maltose and glucose. And finally, through that, we can absorb it into our body as well. So we can divide it into two processes where we have the mechanical process as well as the chemical process. So when we want to speak about the mechanical process of digestion, it means the physical nature of the food is altered in this case. It means that we take whatever the food that we have and we can change it into a different state. For example, if you have a solid state, by munching, we can make it into a semi-solid or a liquid. That is why we have given you the example where we break down the food into small pieces. If you take something and start chewing, it can be a biscuit or a piece of meat or whatever. It breaks down into small, small pieces. So we can call this as mechanical process. That mechanical process happens in our stomach also. Because you can see stomach is actually a muscular structure. So when we start to churn, that means when the grinding and stuff goes on, there is a mechanical process in that as well. And the second thing is the chemical process. So when we speak about the chemical process, we should understand that we have to use chemicals. That is what we mean when we say chemical process. So there are some complex compounds that are not soluble, insoluble. So using enzymes, I hope that you know what enzymes are, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Using enzymes, we can convert them into some other format, some simpler format, so that it can be converted. For example, in our mouth, we have our salivary glands, which I will show you in a very short time. So using our amylase, the salivary amylase, which we call as thiolin, we are PE silent. Using this enzyme, we can convert the starch into maltose. So when we speak about digestive system, we know that usually when you say digestive system, it has to start with organs. So a collection of organs which performs the digestive function can be known as digestive system, right? So what do you think is the basic structural and the functional unit of a human being? What is the basic structural and functional unit?
Cell.
Yeah, obviously. So you have the cell, and the cell, when you have a collection of cells that form the same function and has a similar structure or whatever, it becomes a tissue, and the tissues form into organs, then you have the system. And finally, you have the unit. So similarly, the organs that perform the function of digestion is known as the digestive system. So when we speak about the human digestive system, it is actually a continuous tube. So a single cube starts with our mouth and ends in our anus. So it actually is like a computer system where you input something and there is an output. So I hope that you are doing IT as well, where you get input, process and output. So a sort of a similar process takes place in our digestive system as well. So if they ask you to write the main function of digestive system, you can go through these things. So we have the food digestion, where you're breaking down into smaller pieces, then using chemicals and breaking them further. So the main functions can be divided into three. First, we have to take whatever that is given to us via our mouth, and then we have to digest it. Digestion, we know that there are two types of digestion. What are they? Can you remember them? We just saw them.
Chemical digestion and mechanical digestion.
Yes, we have the chemical process and we have the mechanical process as well. Then using those processes, we can start to digest our food. And whatever that we digest, we will try to absorb it into our system. So if there are some end products and if it is made out of simple molecules, we can absorb them. Most of the molecules, we can absorb them. So we try to absorb most of the molecules. That is the second function of the digestive system. And there may be some stuff which cannot be absorbed by us. For example, if you take cellulose, which is a polysaccharide that is found in plants, especially in green plants, cellulose, it is the structural material. You might have studied that in your first unit maybe. Yeah. Where you can, so those things can be digested mostly by animals such as goats and cows, these sort of cattle. But we cannot digest. So in that case, what happens is, we excrete them. So removal of undigested material from the body is also another function. I hope you can see a photo in this one, right? A picture?
Yes.
Yeah, this is from the courtesy of Encyclopedia Britannica. If you go through their website, you can find this. So this picture outlines the main organs which are in our digestive system and which are associated with the digestive system. For example, you can see that it starts in the mouth, the tube, and ends in anus. Then we can see, when you see the mouth, that part of that area, that cavity area, is known as buccal cavity. We will go to that a bit in deep later. Can you see something known as epiglottis?
Yeah.
Yes, so that is quite important. Just remember that, because we might need to go through that again. So we have our salivary gland and we have pharynx. Pharynx, which is common to both our respiratory system and as well as digestive system. Then we have the esophagus, and then the food will pass through the stomach, where a lot of digestion will take place, especially mechanical digestion and a little bit of chemical digestion. Then it will go to the small intestine. Can you see a C-shaped portion passing from stomach to small intestine? Just below the liver. Can you see something like a C? C-shaped.
Yeah.
Just below the, we call, yes, just below the gallbladder and the pancreas. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Yes, we call that as the duodenum, which is a part of the small intestine. So that is also quite an important part of the digestive system. So that is actually the first part of the small intestine, and where a lot of things such as pancreatic juice and bile come in. We'll look into that later as well. After that, the food will be in the small intestine, which is the long small tubular structure that you can find. You can see it in this picture. And in this one, what happens is, finally, this will get digested and most of them will be absorbed, and some of them will be passed on to the larger intestine. In larger intestine, what we can see is actually, it's a big or a tubular structure, and it has a lot of water and undigested material. So So in that case, what happens is in this one particular large intestine, we can see that we also have a small tube end. We call this as appendix. Now, usually sometimes this might get infected. So if there is some infection that happens here, we should be able to understand that because of this infection, we might get something like appendicitis. And finally, when the small intestine and when the food passes to large intestine and it becomes full in the rectum, because rectum is the part that stores the fecal matter, it will pass on to the anus and out of the body. So this is the simple layout of our digestive system. Right. Let's go through detail now, in detail what happens. Now we are going to look at the digestion in the buccal cavity. So what happens to the food in buccal cavity is what we are going to go through here. Now what you can see from here, I hope that you can see this photo clearly. Now yes. I have actually included two photos, A and B. This is not actually two photos, this is rather one photo. But to make it much more clearer, we have included two photos here, right? So we can see that we have the main anatomical structure and another one which has the salivary glands. So we don't have to go through the detailed type of parotid glands or sublingual or submandibular glands in this area because we are still in ordinary level. But just remember, we have just three types of salivary gland, and saliva can ooze from different places. You can see there are some ducts. It can start from here, or it can be poured out from top. So these are the locations of salivary gland in our buccal cavity. So what happens is the mouth, it will open into this cavity. This cavity is known as the buccal cavity. So we have the jaw, the lower one and the upper one. In humans, what jaw can we move? Can we move the upper jaw or can we move the lower jaw?
Lower
one, right? The upper one cannot be moved. If you are a crocodile, you might try to move the upper one, but as we are humans, we don't do that actually. So we have the lower jaw, which can be moved, and it is actually muscular, so we can use the force to do different type of things here. And we also have cheek. If you take the cheek, you can see it is covered by some cells. We call them as epithelial cells as well. Let it be for now. So what happens is when you smell something, actually the sensation of smell comes first. So when you smell something, what happens is your saliva will start to ooze. If you like the particular thing, it will start to ooze. Then what happens is after some time, when you inject the food into your mouth, you will start to churn it or you will start to chew it. So the teeth is responsible for that function. So we have the teeth here. These teeth will help us to chew the stuff. So when the chewing goes on for some time, and the tongue also help us, right? Because using the tongue, we can push it up. So it will help us to make it into a sort of a bowl, and it mixed with the saliva as well. And we call this as a bolus. And this will help us to move it to the next session. So let's see how it helps us finally. So if you take the digestion that helps in the buccal cavity, there are two parts. As you said before, we have the mechanical process and the chemical process as well. So what is the mechanical process that happens in the buccal cavity? It is actually chewing, right? Using the teeth, we munch and do these things, right? And this is actually the chemical part. Starch, maltose, converts to maltose. Now, the thing I have included the word sweet is this. Sometimes you will be eating something like rice, right? You just eat some rice, which is fresh. Your mother has just cooked it or you have just cooked it, and you don't add any sort of curry. If you start munching that rice for some time, let's say that you're munching it for like 2 minutes or 3 minutes, it becomes a bit of sweet. You will get a bit of sweet sensation. Now, the reason for that is the starch that is in rice or in whatever the carbohydrate that you are eating, it may be some biscuit. Usually you can't say biscuit because biscuit has sweeteners as well. If you take like bread or rice, usually rice is much better. If you start munching it for a long time, the starch will convert to maltose. This conversion of maltose is facilitated by an enzyme that is found in our salivary gland. We call this as salivary amylase, or we can call this as thiolene. So the conversion is given to you. Maltose is actually sweet. You might have drunk Mr. Malt and Milo, those things, right?
Yeah.
Have you tried to eat it sometimes as powder?
Yeah.
Yeah, you might have the experience. Do you feel that to be sweet, or does it taste bitter? Which is more, sweet or bitter?
Bitter.
Bitter, right? So it has a sort of a bitter sweet taste. So maltose has sort of a sweet taste. That is why we have that sweet taste in our mouth when we start munching carbohydrate for a long time. Now, do you think you will be able to digest beef in your mouth? In your buccal cavity?
No.
Can you digest?
No.
Right. Now, we'll go for the next step, which is what happens after that. The digested food, which is made into a bolus, a sort of a ball sort of a structure, will be moved to the back of the buccal cavity. So back of the buccal cavity, in the sense, I can show that as well for you in this case. If you take this photo, you can see, right? It will move to the back. Back in the sense, somewhere here. So when it moves to the back of that, you can see that there is something known as uvula. This uvula is actually very important for us because it prevents the particular thing from going up to the nasal cavity and stuff like that. So it will move to pharynx next. So when it comes to pharynx, can you see something known as epiglottis?
Yes.
Yes, this is actually something that can move. So it is a movable structure. So what happens with the movable structure is this. It will start moving. So it will block the food from entering larynx. The larynx has to do with respiratory system, which we will study in our next lesson. So if the food goes into larynx, it will be a problem. So it has to go to esophagus. So that is why this epiglottis is important. It will move to esophagus thereafter. Now we will see how the food moves to esophagus. So if you take esophagus, this is the structure or the photo that is given in your book as well. It is actually a constricted tube. The tube is there. It is highly elastic and it is also constricted. And also it is made up of muscles. So it is a muscular structure. So let me ask you something. If you can remember, you may say it. You might have studied about three different types of muscles that is in our body. Can you remember those things?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. I will help you with one sort of a muscle. You should have to come up with the other types of muscles, right? I'll tell you one type of muscle that we have. Okay. I'll tell the name of the first one. Let's say cardiac. So cardiac is one type of a muscle that we have. Can you tell me other two types of muscles that we have?
Smooth muscle.
Okay, then we have the smooth muscles. Then
skeletal.
Well done. Skeletal is one, right? Skeletal. Now, out of these three, which of the muscles are voluntary and which are not voluntary?
Cardiac and smooth.
Cardiac and smooth are not voluntary, right? Involuntary, right?
Yeah.
And skeletal is actually voluntary, right? Anyway, the reason I want you to just remember this is, I want you to ask, what type of muscle do you find in your esophagus? Are those cardiac, smooth, or skeletal?
Is it smooth?
Yeah, it is smooth, right? Well done. Because if it is skeletal, you should be able to control what you eat. which is something that we can't do actually. So as you can see, we don't use this type of muscles. These muscles are not available. So the muscles inside the esophagus, or the structure, what happens is it can relax and contract. The reason why it can relax and contract is obviously because it is a muscle. That is a property of any muscles that we have. So what happens thereafter is, because of this rhythmic sort of movement, we can see that food passes from esophagus and through esophagus right down to the stomach. So this particular structure is known as esophagus, and this movement is known as peristaltic movement. This type of rhythmic contraction and relaxation will be known as peristaltic movement. Right. Now let's go for digestion in our stomach, which is quite interesting. From this photo, you can see that there are two types of digestion, which is very clearly stated. We have the chemical one and we have the mechanical one, right? So the mechanical digestion is which happens in the stomach. We can see that because of the contraction and the relaxation of this stomach and the wall of the stomach, which we call as peristalsis. This term you might need, you might not need, but just remember, because of the rhythmic contraction, the food is mixed well, it is broken down into small pieces, it is made into a chime. So this happens. So how long do you think the food stays in our stomach, roughly? How many hours? Yes, around 3 hours, right? So it stays in our stomach for around 3 hours. So what happens is, here we have the stomach here, and to digest the proteins, what happens is we have an enzyme, the pepsin enzyme, along with acids such as hydrochloric acid, which is found in our gastric juices. This will help us to digest the proteins that is available here. So finally, this chyme will have digested proteins, which may be partially digested, and we have some digested carbohydrate that is coming from our mouth, from the amylase, which is tiling, and we have some undigested part as well. We have lipids, which is not digested at all. Then we also have water, minerals and vitamins, and they will be sent to the next stage, which is to the duodenum of the small intestine. Now we can see that I have given some points for you to understand. So it will last for around 3 hours. Sometimes it may be more, sometimes it might be less. So there is an average value for about 3 hours. The digestion in stomach will take place. So what happens is, this bolus will be broken down and mixed well into a chyme. So because of this chyme, you know the composition of chyme just we stated. We have undigested protein and we have partially digested protein as well. Why partially digested? Because of this pepsin and acid. Then we have some carbohydrate that is digested. Where do you think this digested carbohydrate comes from?
It's not clear. Your voice is breaking.
How is it? Is it clear now?
Now it's fine.
Okay, right. So where do you think the undigested and digested carbohydrate comes from? So undigested carbohydrate, I can say that it comes directly from our mouth cavity. Where do you think the digested part comes from?
Small.
Yes, it also comes from our mouth or buccal cavity, because can you remember that we studied that tiling helps in digestion?
Yeah.
Yes. So that part is also there. And here we have, I have written two chemical names, chemical formulas. Actually, can you see those things and tell me what those are?
Water.
H2O, water and? 6H2LO6 is actually the formula of glucose, right?
Glucose.
Yes, so we have fructose as well, but anyway, in this case, we speak about glucose, and some drugs may be absorbed into the system in our stomach. So when the stomach contracts, what happens is when your stomach is empty, the contraction, number of contraction will increase. So when you have an increased amount of contraction in the stomach, it will cause an increased amount of pain. This pain will be registered in our brain as hunger. That is how we become hungry. So the concept of hunger is also there with you as well, right? Now let us go to the next one. Yes.
Then what about those gastric juices? Those are the ones, if we don't consume food, then it will increase. Is it how the hunger we feel?
Gastric juice has to do with digestion part. Now I'll come to that part as well. As you just mentioned, it is there in our syllabus as well. So if you have gastric juice, actually contains pepsin and hydrochloric acid. So that is the main contents of hydrochloric, the gastric juice. So what happens is, if you are hungry or if you have a high amount of gastric juice in your stomach, it will go cause gastritis pain. You know that pain, right? You might have experienced sometimes where if you have some oily food or if you have some. So gastric juice, as you mentioned, is to do with the gastritis and digestion. It has got nothing to do with the digestion or the involvement of hunger here.
Okay.
But as you mentioned, gastric juice may induce hunger, which is not the main thing. It is a minor thing. It can induce hunger as well, right? Okay, let's go through the next one, which is, has to do with digestion that happens in our small intestine. So if you have problems, please ask them as well. I have forgot to write the title here. But anyway, I have included only a part of the small intestine here. Now you can see this C-shaped part. There's a name for that. Can you tell the name which we use for that?
Is that...
The name is given here as well.
Duodenum.
Yes, duodenum or duodenum, we call that as the C-shaped part. I told you it's quite important. Let's see why it is important. First of all, from this picture, we can understand we have a C-shaped part and a particular duct. We can see there are two different types of duct that joins to make a common duct. So let's consider this particular organ. We call this as pancreas. So pancreas will excrete pancreatic juice. This pancreatic juice has amylase, lipase and trypsin. These enzymes are available in pancreatic juice. At the same time, we have the gallbladder, and from gallbladder we have the bile pigments. Bile pigments are also there. So these bile pigments may contain salts, and we have bicarbonate ions, then water. These things also will be available. And in intestine, we have intestinal juice, which contains maltase, sucrase, lactase, peptidase, and we have some mucus as well. So actually what happens here is, using these three different types of combination of juices and bile, chemical digestion will take place. So if I ask you, where does chemical digestion of food take place mainly in our human body, what organ will you mention?
Stomach or small intestine?
It's small intestine, right? The mechanical one, as you just told me earlier, the mechanical process will take place in stomach, the main mechanical process, and the main chemical digestion of food and absorption will take place within the small intestine, right? So it is C-shaped, the starting part, and it is known as duodenum, and it is roughly around 7 meters. So an average adult can have up to 7 meters of small intestine, right? So all of these things will open from a single pore, which we known as sphincter of Oddi, So through that only we get all these juices, especially bile pigments and intestinal pancreatic juice will come through this, and then it will be mixed with the chyme that comes from stomach, right? So what happens? What are the enzymes that is found in food digestion in small intestine, and what organ sect is that, and what is the substrate or the food to which it acts on, and what are the end products? Let's go through that as well. Right. If you take the pancreas, which we just saw earlier, we spoke that it will be able to put out or secrete three different types of enzymes. Trypsin, amylasin, lipase or lipase. However you call it, it doesn't matter. So if you speak about trypsin, it will act on protein and make it into polypeptides. So you might have studied about polypeptides earlier in the lesson, right?
Yes.
Good. Then we have amylase, and we spoke about amylase and the structure and how it works. It will act on starch and convert it to maltose. Maltose is not actually a monosaccharide. It is actually a disaccharide. And then we have lipase. Lipase will act on lipid and convert it to fatty acids and glycerol. So we have fatty acids and glycerols, which are end products of lipid. But starch is actually converted into maltose. Now we have to break that maltose as well to the next level. So what happens in small intestine? Maltase enzyme will act on maltose and convert it into glucose. Sucrase will act on sucrose. Sucrose is actually the sugar that we consume, and what can be found in sugarcane and stuff like that. It will be broken down into glucose and fructose. Then we have lactase, which will act on lactose enzyme, which will break down into glucose and galactose. And finally, peptidase, this will act on polypeptides. So polypeptides is actually the second layer of protein, and it will break down into amino acids. Now we can see that from here, the carbohydrates are completely converted into, or mostly converted into, monosaccharide like glucose, galactose, fructose and stuff like that. And then we have the amino acids, which is actually from the digestion of protein. Then we have fatty acids and glycerol, which is from lipid. So you might have studied about carbohydrate, proteins and lipid and nucleic acid in your first unit, right?
Yes.
And you can find that from here, the major three ones, except nucleic acid, the other three are broken down into small portions or the building blocks of them. So if you take the end products of digestion, we can write it down like this. So you might have written the same sort of formula when you study about these things in your previous lesson, which is the starting or the first lesson in that is given to you. Carbohydrate will be broken into monosaccharides, as we mentioned. Then we have proteins, which will be broken down into amino acids. Then lipids are broken down into fatty acids and glycerol. And some of them will be absorbed as well. For example, these monosaccharides will be absorbed. Vitamins, amino acids will be absorbed. Mineral salts also will be absorbed. So this absorption also will take place in our small intestine. So we speak about absorption in small intestine. So we have to understand why is this happening, or what are the features that is available in small intestine. So you can see that, let me zoom it out for you so it will be easy for us. Right. Okay. So you can see from this photo, we have the small intestine. And an enlarged portion of the small intestine is also given. And from that, another portion is also given to us. So we have the basic one. The first one is actually, as you can see, it is the small intestine. Then what do you think is the second structure that is given to you? It is known as villi or villi. And then we have the third structure, which is known as microvilli or microvilli. Can you see the actual pictures that is given below as well? You have the actual pictures also given to you. The real ones taken from a microscope.
Yeah.
Right, okay. So let's go through the features that is available here. I should take the this particular structure that is given to you, which is actually the small intestine or the parts of it. It is actually a long tube. So how many meters of it can you find it within you? What is the length of small intestine? Can you remember?
7.
Yes, it's actually 7 meters, right? And inside the wall or the inner wall has some circular folds. So it actually means that the inner wall is longer than the outer wall. So the inner wall has more surface area. So in that we have circular-like or the finger-like projections. We call that as villi. You saw that in this particular picture as well.
Yes.
And that villi has microvilli. So on top of that, we have some more folds. So actually it has a very, very large surface area. So a large surface area means it is easy to absorb. And finally, the epithelial lining is very thin. So we can easily absorb into the blood system and our lymphatic system as well. So that is what we call as highly vascularized. You can see that word here, highly vascularized. If you take this picture, let me zoom it in again for you. You can see that there are different vessels available here, right? You can see that there are blood vessels that's coming in, arteries, veins, the lymphatic system. So it is very, very highly efficient, to be honest, for absorption to take place. Okay, did you get the concept now? Okay, right. The meeting will end within some minutes, inshallah. If it ends, just join back again later. Now,
okay.
Let's go through the processes in the large intestine. So the large intestine, we don't need actually a big elaborate photo to explain to that as well. Usually, if you take the outside view, that means when you just look at it physically, we can see that the large intestine is actually bigger than the small intestine. It looks that way. But actually, it is the other way around. The large intestine is only 1.5 meters in length, ideally. But the small intestine is much longer, which is 7 meters. So the large intestine will start from cecum, or cecum actually, not cesium actually. Cecum, and it will end in anus, via rectum. So as most of the nutrients are already absorbed in our small intestine, the amount of nutrients that is available in the large intestine is very low. It's very obvious, right? You can understand that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, and we spoke about cellulose early as well, and it contains undigested cellulose and water. So even though cellulose is not something, or cellulose is not something that we can consume, or which is actually absorbed into the system, it is quite important. We'll go through why a little bit later. Because if you have cellulose in your system, it will help us to retain water. So ability to retain water is very important when defecating, when we pass out the fecal matter. So this undigested cellulose and water is available in the large intestine. So if somebody asks you what is the main function of large intestine, you can say it has to do with absorption of water. Because we studied of absorption of food was already studied by us, and we saw that, we learned that the small intestine helps us to absorb a lot of food materials by breaking them down and doing some chemical digestion as well. But water absorption has to do with large intestine. So, and whatever the material or the matter that is available in our large intestine at the end, we call that as fecal matter. It is yellow color. It is due to the bile pigment that is available. We spoke about bile and the pigments and bicarbonates and water that is there. So one of the color of the bile pigment is yellow color. So this bile, and finally we are speaking about the bile pigments. So this fecal matter has undigested food, and it has microorganisms, then it has epithelial cells, and it also has mucus. So mucus will facilitate passing out of food actually. Right. And finally, we have come to the last session of our main session actually. So this has to do with the diseases and disorders which are associated with our digestive system. So let's start with the most common one, which is known as gastritis. So gastritis, this particular disease, is because of the inflammation that happens within the stomach. Now if you take our stomach, it is lined with a lot of mucus, and there are a lot of cells in that as well. But sometimes what happens is, because of the reaction of this acid, hydrochloric acid, it so happens that this particular lining may be under the threat of inflammation. So you will have a burning sensation within the stomach. So this burning sensation is known as gastritis. We call this as acidity as well. So what are the main symptoms? First one is regurgitation of acid to mouth. So you may feel sort of a vomiting sensation where you get some acid in the mouth and it will taste something like it will have a sour sort of a taste. It will taste like you are eating some sort of lemon. So that sort of a different sort of a taste you might feel within your mouth. So regurgitation of acid to mouth. The reason that you feel that sort of a taste is because most of the acids have that taste. Don't drink it or taste it. But usually it has a sort of a lemon taste. When you eat lemon or lime, the taste that you get is the sort of the taste that you have in acids. And the most common one is the burning sensation or the burning feeling and a sort of a pain in our stomach. So this is also a quite common one that we can find everywhere. So if it is not treated, if we don't get proper medication, or if we don't get consult a doctor, or this particular gastritic problem does not dissolve over time, what happens is ulcers will start appearing in our stomach. Ulcers are sort of like lumps, like small lumps. It will appear in our stomach, and it may happen in the duodenal wall as well. So finally, what will happen is, because of this, it will start to bleed. So this bleeding can occur because of gastritis. So what are the main reasons? Why do we get gastritis? It's usually skipping of meals. Now this particular problem is very highly available or prevalent among school-going children. Especially the students I have met from in grade 10, 9, and especially in O-level classes. So the reason I mentioned O-level classes is because students from O-level classes, most of the time, because of high workload and the number of tuitions that they attend and the pressure of the social situation that they are in, they tend to skip meals, sometimes voluntarily and sometimes involuntarily. For example, I'll ask you a classical question. Let's say that you have classes from morning 6 a.m. up to 10 a.m. and the teachers who conduct those classes are very strict. Will you take a break or will you not take a break? What will you do?
Not take a break.
Not take a break, right? So that is an involuntary reaction, because you can't do anything, because you know that if you take a break and you get 10 minutes, you feel that the teacher may not understand and you may get some sort of a punishment or a scolding. So you are forced to skip your meal. That's one thing. The second thing is, sometimes let's say that there is something being cooked in your house and it is one of those dishes that you don't like at all. There's nothing to eat. So usually, I'm asking a very general question, if there is something that is given to you which you do not like, will you eat it or will you skip it?
Skip it.
Yes, that's very natural. Skip it. And some other thing that I have seen that is very prevalent among the students in Sri Lanka especially is, if there might be a particular student who is a bit square when they are in grade 8 or grade 9, after some time they may feel that, or somebody will make a comment to them telling that you look a bit fat or something like that, some sort of a body shaming comment will be made to them. It happens a lot of time. So that will affect your conscience and you will start to skip meals just to lose weight. So that you might become a bit more attractive and your dresses will fit a bit better. So that is also a very prevalent condition that happens in Sri Lanka. Whatever happens, we should learn to love the body that we have and we should know how to maintain it as well using relaxation and exercise and good dietary plans. But anyway, we should never ever skip meals, because many people think that if they skip meals, they will consume less and it will help them to lower their stress and sort of things. No, it doesn't happen at all. If you skip meals, it will be a problem. Right. Second thing, consumption of acidic and spicy food. So that this is a very instantaneous reaction. Most of the people, when they get gastritis, they will have a reaction to spicy food. For example, eating, let's say, some shortage, which is very oily. And it is very spicy as well. You have a lot of chilies and chili pieces and stuff like that. So that will contribute to having gastritis. So you can see that especially among Muslims, where this reaction is very instantaneous. Suddenly they will have some sort of, they will eat something and that reaction will come out very fast. The reason I'm telling Muslims is not because the others don't follow it, but most of the time Muslims, we are used to this fast food culture where we have a lot of stuff. Right, next one is excessive smoking and alcohol consumption. If you smoke excessively and have a habit of alcohol consumption, one of the problems that you might get is gastritis. But gastritis is not the problem that you have to worry about if you are in that habit. And finally, and one of the most important things that I have found among our children is mental stress. So the reason I highlight this very often to most of the parents is that usually when you have morning classes, let's say the school organizes classes at 6 a.m. If the child is habituated, if the habit of the child is to eat at 7:30 a.m., they won't eat at 6 a.m. and come to school. It's very difficult to build a habit of eating. So what happens is usually the meal will be skipped. So that will also cause a lot of problems. So these are the main reasons for gastritis. Let's look at another problem that we have, which is constipation. Constipation, we can say it very, comically as unlimited outgoing. It's a comical term that we can say, where the outgoing is unlimited. We can say that as well, but we don't use that in our scientific background, but to make a sort of a fun gesture, we use that. So what is constipation? Constipation means having a difficulty in defecation. That means difficulty in passing out the fecal matter. That is because the fecal matter has become very hard. So the fecal matter will become very hard if you don't defecate on time. If you hold it for a long time, what happens is in the large intestine, the water will be absorbed continuously. So continual absorption of water will make the fecal matter hard because there is no water in the fecal matter. So what are the reasons? First thing is consumption of food with low dietary fiber. So do you know that that lot of people eat food that has very low amount of dietary fiber? So what do I mean by that? Okay, let me ask you something very frankly. Do you like to eat green leaves?
Not most of the time.
Yes, not most of the time. The reason is because it's not that tasty. Usually people prefer meat or something like soya or whatever that is available to them. But eating green leaves is not their first choice. But green leaves are a very important part of our diet. The reason is, first of all, the most of the content that is available in green leaf may be water and cellulose. Can you digest cellulose in your human system?
No. Yeah.
No. Actually, no, right? If you can digest cellulose, you might be a goat or a cow or something like that. I'm not making a hint, but I'm just telling the fact as it is.
Yeah.
Cellulose cannot be digested. But it is very important to help you pass out the undigested matter. Let's say that you have eaten something that has no, let's say that you are eating only potatoes. Potato have very, very low dietary fiber. So that means the fiber content is very low. You will find a problem to pass out. In the sense, I mean defecate. So you should have food that has a balanced amount of dietary fibers. So that's quite important. Second thing is not taking enough water. I have seen the students, especially in seminars. Now, as it is COVID-19, we don't have some seminars, and you are very fortunate to study at home. And especially during class hours and when it is very stressful, we don't take water. Because taking water has caused the myth that it will help, it will make us to go to the washroom all the time. And the student in our class will have a different view when we go to the washroom. So that is actually a myth. So water consumption is very important, especially to look beautiful. If I put it that way, that is all right. And if you don't take enough water, it may cause constipation as well. And postponing of defecation, which I told you earlier. You might have taken enough water, but you are just holding it in. Even when you get a chance, you are not able to do that. Means that will have an adverse effect and it will cause constipation. Now let's look at typhoid. Typhoid is a fever that has to do with water, and most of the time we speak about typhoid fever as well. Anyway, let's see what happens. It is caused by a bacterium. Bacterium can enter the body via the mouth, or it can enter via the fecal matter, or it can be transferred by flies, or it can be infected by consumption of contaminated food. So that is why we have to wash the food very well before cutting. So what are the symptoms? What are the basic symptoms? Means you might have some pain in the arms and legs. Then you might have some headache or fever. So when it goes a little bit aggressive, there might be constipation. That issue might come again. And there might be plaque that covers the tongue. So plaque on the tongue is like this. If you push out your tongue, if it is completely covered with white color material, this white color material is known as plaque. And you can see that building of plaque in the teeth as well. So plaque covered tongue. And if it goes a bit further, you might get stomach ache because of this bacteria and the problem that it causes within the stomach. And if it is highly aggressive, you might get diarrhea. And finally, you might also get ulcers, and it may cause intestinal bleeding as well. So you might get stool that has blood in it. And finally, to end our program, so we will be speaking about diarrhea. So diarrhea is caused by virus, or it can be caused by bacteria or some sort of a parasite. So this diarrhea, as you already know, is transmitted via the feces of an infected person. In Sri Lanka, the amount of diarrhea or the diarrhea infected persons are very low because we do have a satisfactory amount of sanitary resources, to be honest. So if there is good sanitation, the amount of diarrhea infected persons also will be low. But in some countries where it's still developing, similar to Sri Lanka, but which is in a lower rank, let's say, for example, the sanitation that is available in India or Bangladesh, which are very large countries, obviously, are quite not that as good as Sri Lanka. So the amount of diarrhea infected persons or patients that is available there is quite high. what are the symptoms is, the main symptom, as we already know, is the release of fecal matter in the state of a liquid. So usually it should be a solid or a semi-solid. It will be liquid state. So what happens is, after that, because of this, because of diarrhea or this infection, the large intestine will not be able to absorb water into our system properly. So what happens is, we might become dehydrated. Because there is not enough water, we might become dehydrated. I'll ask you some questions so that you might be able to understand this concept a bit more. Have you participated in sports meet?
Yes.
Right. I'll give you a classical example. Let's say that you are going to the ground early in the morning. Suddenly they tell you, okay, from next month we have sports meet, so you have practices and you have gone to the ground. Let's say you went to the ground at 8 o'clock and you came back at 2 o'clock. You went for practices, you did some exercises and you did some netball or basketball, whatever, some sort of practice, and you came back and you have forgot to drink water. How will you feel? Will you feel tired or will you feel dehydrated?
Dehydrated.
You will feel tired because you might not have practiced for a long time, but mainly dehydrated. That is because you don't have enough water in the body. That dehydrated is caused by you going out and doing some practices in the ground, right?
Yeah.
But this dehydration is caused because of the problem of diarrhea. So I think that you have got the concept clearly, and this is the subject that has to do with digestion. So do you have any questions which are related to digestion now?